Thank you for the introduction. My name is Kyle King.
I'm Josh Bob.
My name is Evelyn Rubel.
I'm Lee Bogner.
I'm Tim Block.
And we're Team Bikes. For the past 3 years, we've worked to build a prototype stationless bike share using a novel smartphone. To explain, let me start by talking about a station-based example close to home, Capital Bike Share in DC. Capital Bike Share has a fleet of bright red bikes parked at stations throughout DC. You can rent these bikes by going up to a station, renting them to go to the next station where you can walk and explore the city. Capital Bike Share has opened up new potential for people to experience a sustainable, healthy lifestyle. However, Capital Bike Share has many shortcomings when trying to bring it to a college campus. The docking stations themselves can cost $50,000 to $100,000 for installation costs. They also have a large footprint and are very space inefficient in the number of bikes they can fit. For both of these reasons, trying to put bike shares on a campus means that you can only have a few. And Capital Bike Share is based on station-to-station commutes. So as a user, there's only a few directions you can go across campus, which means you have to walk a long distance to get to the first station and a long distance from the second station. This creates issues that walking the shortest distance may be more efficient than biking. Our solution is to utilize the infrastructure that's already on campus, the bike racks that universities put a lot of money into and developing, and the perfect locations for students. Our system uses a cost-effective smart lock built to apply the same features as a Capital Bike Share station, such as security for the bike, access for registered users, and tracking of bikes so people can find them. It's also fits in a smaller and substantially cheaper form. In this way, the smart lock provides all the same features someone wants in a personal bike, but also the convenience of Capital Bike Share on a very tight, close-knit college campus. Previewing the smart lock, it sits right below the bike seat. There's space for all of our electronics and smart components. Then there's the ring to lock into the bike rack. To accomplish this, we broke our team into four subteams. First, locking. They ensured the physical security of our bike. Second, the access control team. They saw the digital security of our bike and the renting protocol. Our geolocation subteam built the web application and wireless communication system. And finally, the business team tackle our financial and user issues to make sure we deliver on the goals we saw. Next, you'll hear about the technology and design that went into building this novel bike home. To start us off, Josh will talk about the locking system.
Thank you, Kyle. So one of the most important parts of making a bike share is to actually be able to secure the bike and not have it stolen. To do this, we first started by testing some existing locks. Here we have photos of our team developing fixtures that we used to torture test some of the locks on the market. Specifically, the Kryptonite beam lock and the OnGuard Fulton. We put these in a machine and pulled them apart and measured the force at fracture. So here we have a plot of two U-locks and two folding locks. But we discovered that at failure, they both had about the same deformation, but the U-lock had about 2.5 times the force required in order to break it. From this data, we were able to come up with two prototypes that we chose to pursue, a loop lock concept and a modified U-lock concept. In April of 2015, we held a focus group to get user feedback on the locking aspects as well as the other aspects. They found that the U-lock resembled, the loop lock resembled the U-lock, so they still had that peace of mind. But the loop lock also had other features that made it more effective for our system. When riding, it sits beneath the seat, so your legs and feet don't hit it. Bike UMD wanted the system to be able to lock only around bike racks instead of fences and other posts. And with the way that the lock sits beneath the seat, you can put it on almost any bike on the market, whereas the modified U-lock requires specific frames and very much limit the number of bikes that we'd be able to implement in our system. To start this, we started 3D modeling using CAD and began printing different iterations using printers available here on campus. On the left, we have the blue lock that was our first prototype. We quickly moved away from the hinge design that you can see there and evolved more into the locks further on the right, and ended in this lock we have here. We used much higher resolution 3D printers to finalize the design so we can still see how it interacts with the arm. The colors that are printed on the arms are a stress analysis. Red is more stress and blue is less stress, so we can see where the lock will be most likely to bend and where we need to reinforce it in later designs. The collars themselves are machined, so we were also able to see the machining process, so this could be repeatable and manufacturable in the future. And the electronics box houses all the electronics as well as the pin that secures it. constantly have it locks, we have this animation here, partner technology. As the pin is removed, the cog is then able to rotate. As the servo receives a signal that allows it to lock, the servo powers on and moves the pin back, and it's no longer skewering the collar as well as the rest of the metal components, and allows the loops to freely rotate. The reverse is true of the locking mechanism, where if from its unlocked position, users can then rotate back in the locked position, and the pin then re-skewers all the metal components, including the collar, and prevents any more rotation. By doing this, we turn off power to the entire servo, and we have magnets or springs in the back that then force it closed. This defaults to a locked state, so that if you lose power, you don't lose the bike, and also you can save power, not even the servo power at all times. We have this design and we put it on bikes. We did test it recently, and we were able to move it around between bike racks and different users, and it was effective. Now I'm going to pass it on to them and access control.
Thanks, Josh. So the goal of the access control subteam was to create a means of allowing users to access a system that balanced power consumption, security, and convenience. The first step in this was picking a technology with which to identify users, and we settled on near field communication, or NFC. This is a technology that you see cropping up a lot these days at point of sale locations like restaurants and shops, and entry points such as walking to a metro station. The advantage of this from our perspective is that it's a technology that users are familiar with, but at the same time provides a high degree of inherent security because the read distance between your reader and the tag that a user is using is fairly small, meaning it's difficult to intercept that communication. So this ensures security for the user's identity and our system. The means by which we identify our users is the MyFair Smart Card. This is analogous to a smart trip card that you would use when walking onto the metro. It contains electronic circuitry on the inside that performs a high degree of encryption and then stores that encrypted data. The advantage of this for us is that we can talk to this MyFair card using the standard NFC protocol and not worry about having to secure or encrypt the data. That's all taken care of on the card. So this just is one less thing for us as developers and users to worry about. So how does that NFC protocol reading thing work anyway? Well, at the heart of it is our Arduino Uno microcontroller. And Arduino Uno microcontroller is an open source hardware and software platform that can take and read, well, can distribute signals to and from electronic devices connected to it. In our case, one of these modules is the ElectHaus NFC V3 module. This is a commercially available NFC module that can communicate with an Arduino. We chose this over other modules primarily for its size. Much like the other modules, it reads quickly and at a short distance. But this one, unlike others, has the reading circuitry and the antenna combined on a small package. This means it's easier to configure within our system, and we have more choices in where we place it. Additionally, it only requires 4 connections to the Arduino to function, which means we're only worried about the signal integrity of 4 wires, and we can fully control that. The reason we're worried about things like signal integrity with our electronics is that the code the Arduino is running is fairly complicated. What you have here is a diagram of the control flow of the program that the Arduino goes through as we're trying to allow a user to access a button. We start at the not reading idle state. We progress to reading where we're taking in the tag data. We try to decide, is this user allowed to use the bike or not? If they are, we open the bike, allow the user to ride around, and then once it's relocked, we record that final location. The key here is that any number of things can go wrong in this step, in any of these steps, and if they do, we're sent back to the closed, locked shut, bike's not moving state, and we have to go through a series of tests before we allow it to be opened again. And this certainly we certainly want to avoid this. So in the end, the access control subteam succeeded in taking the user's ID and moving that from a MyFair smart card through an NFC reader to our Arduino, where it's then passed out to our wireless network. And with more details on how that wireless network works and what it does, here's Luke.
Thank you. So when you remove the stations from a bike share system, you also remove the user's ability to effectively locate the bikes. In response to this, Team Bikes formed the geolocation subteam, which had 2 primary tasks. The first of which was to develop a communication system so that we could talk to the bikes at every time to figure out where they are. The second task was to develop a web application so that users could log on, locate, and reserve their bikes at their convenience. So this first task was the communication system, which we elected to use the Zigbee Mesh Network protocol. To do so, we used some of the hardware that you see on the screen behind me, with the XB module, the RF interface, and the Adafruit GPS to locate the bike. We interfaced with these devices to be using their Arduino or the Raspberry Pi. So within the XP, you can configure one of three ways, the first of which is as an end device. So an end device in a wireless sensor network typically acts as the data collector, or in our case, the data being collected is the GPS location of the device, or any other information that's being passed to us from the other substrates. This information is then passed through a router which acts as a computer up to the coordinator, which is the central point of our network. The coordinator also acts as the bridge between the ZigBee network that we set up and the web application. So this network topology that I just described can be seen on the picture here, where we have end devices located over mics, passing data through routers to the coordinator up to the web application. A big selling point of why we chose ZigBee is scalability. Once we set up our network to cover the campus, we can actually set up just a single additional router towards the edge of campus to cover some more off-campus housing that is going up as we see around campus. So another point that we have on scalability is through strategically configuring the coordinators and end devices, we can actually set up multiple independent networks that allow for the end device to pass from one network to the other. What this means is we can have a network on North Campus that has a bike that rides down to another network on the South Campus, and the bikes still make their way back to the web application. So in order to place these networks on campus, we first have to characterize the architecture of the XP modules. And to do this, we built this little device that had GPS and an end device XP module. We then were able to carry this device around campus to collect signal strength at locations as a function of time. The first test location that we used was Central Campus, or the Calvin Mall. Once we got there, we set up a network by just putting a single coordinator in front of the mall, where the C is located on the map here. Once that was placed and set up, we actually carried our little device that I just showed you around the entire span of the mall. And then after collecting this data, we were able to plot a heat map. So this heat map here has the red as the strongest signal fading out to the green being the weaker signal. This was able to show us the effect of distance and buildings that hold the signal strength. The McKelvin Mall is actually about just over 1,000 feet, so you can actually see that the signal actually worked pretty far until hitting the building at the other end. The next piece of useful information came actually from user policy, which then we'll get into in a little bit. But the main part here is that we tell the users that they're restricted to park bikes solely at bike racks and things. Taking this information into account in the communication system, we find that we don't actually need to cover all of campus, but rather we only need to cover the bike racks on campus. So with this information, we then carried our device around to all the bike racks around the McKelvin Mall, which are designated here by the blue squares. And from this, we were able to find that just the same coordinator in the McKelvin, we could actually hit all the bike racks adjacent to the mall, which is actually kind of impressive here. So we then repeated this test at multiple locations throughout campus with a single coordinator and also with multiple routers too. And after doing this, we were able to characterize the arc nature of the XP models enough so that we could propose a system that would cover 100% of the bike racks on campus with just 56 nodes. But to transition from this to the website, we're now going to have Howard.
Thank you. So first, thank you. So now we have the XPs happily talking to each other. We need something for them to talk to. In our case, this was an endpoint, database, and web application. We looked at considerable alternatives, such as Meteor, Beam, or Ruby on Rails. But we found that Meteor was the best decision. At the time, it was really unproven, and few people were starting to use it. We saw its potential as a new real-time Internet of Things service that would take off, and our luck paid off. The big benefit of it was that using a framework is very difficult. The decision we made could have gone terribly wrong. Often frameworks go out of fashion and fade out more than clothing styles. So this one stayed around and shown it's made it to a stable release, which means that it'll have long support in the future. This is essentially, we have to choose a framework because a lot of the core functions inside of an app are the same for every application. So spending lots of time building really basic components of a website is counterintuitive. Using this, we can spend time building on what's new. And so this way we can do rapid development. We can also tap into a large library of open source packages, which we also return in submitted packages to ourselves. So showing some of the features that we built into the application, we'll start with the map, the most common feature for using. Loading up on mobile or website, they can see a location of where they are in comparison to bikes that are on campus, demonstrated by the gray icons. From here, a user can so as a user is on campus, you can imagine that we have a high flux of users going in and out of our system, bikes are being rented and returned at a constant rate, especially right in between classes. So as a user, constantly refresh and not know where the bikes are is really confusing. So we focused a lot on drilling down to that real-time component. This way, when a user opens the app, it's constantly updated as long as we're getting information fed in the system from both Emily and Luke's systems. When a byte's rented, it disappears from the system, and anyone has it open, it will disappear within a second. This means that users have a very high level of trust in the system and can expect it to work consistently. We also consider that most of our users will be using from a mobile application. This means that load time is a big issue. We spend a lot of time optimizing images and content to make sure that they were getting just the information they needed and not bogged down a ton of data being sent to them. We also considered security. We store people's phone numbers and emails, which is essential for an administrator to contact the user in case of an issue. However, when other users try to access this creates issues. So we call it a scalable authentication system. It prevents users from accessing other users' data, but gives root access to different levels. Further, the app has come a really long way. As you can see from the early picture up there, some of our design was very raw, and we received a lot of feedback from the focus group pointing to the root identity and the lack of an explanation of how to use the system. We took this feedback and informal peer feedback during the process and continued to drive down to what we found was important to users. The website you can see today now has a consistent user interface and then also a visual explanation of how to use the bike share. On a technical note, the users were terrified that coming out of class there would be a sudden chaotic rush to go rent a bike. To combat this, we built a reservation feature. In much the same way that we have a real-time application, we could build on top of that. When users click any of the gray icons, it turns orange and lets them know that they've now reserved that bike for 5 minutes. Behind the scenes, there's a cron task that runs to time that out in 5 minutes, or if they rent any bike they see, they'll become available for other users. But users weren't just our only users. We've got administrators that make the system possible. They have to see all the bikes, whether they're being prepared and whether they're available, or if they're in stream. So from here, they can drill down and search for the bike's status. Then they can see information for their mechanics or information about users. But going back up to that first table, they can not only see an at-a-glance look at the entire bikes in their system, they can drill down and look at a specific bike. From here, they can see information such as everywhere that bike's been for the past day, which is useful if there's intentional damage to the bike, or if otherwise there's the potential in a theft situation, they can track it down and resolve errors. So now we're going to pass it off to Tim to talk about the business side of things.
Great. Thanks, Kyle. So I'm part of the business team, the last time team before. Our main objective was twofold. One, to understand the users, and two, to understand the nuances, the problems that can come up from running a station this way on a college campus. So to begin, why are we called Red Guard? So we got our inspiration from Schedule. That's our scheduling software. That's an engineering student that goes to many classes. My schedule, a lot less than a student. But as you can see, those red bars show up as a warning showing you that the student would have a difficult time going from one end of campus to the other. And our job is, for the bike shares, to eliminate those red bars and replace it with red. So what do we get back from our focus group? From the focus group, we saw that there was an interest in the bike share from the participants. Some of them said that they would be daily users, while others said that it would be nice to have emergency situations. Also, some of the students didn't even have bikes to begin with on campus. And this offered them an opportunity to have bikes going forward, which they were happy about. The other problem that we looked to address were bike deserts. So a bike desert is essentially an area of on campus where most likely bikes will not be, even if they should be there. These might be at the top of the hills. These college students might be lazy and not want to actually ride a bike back up the hill. More of the residence halls, where students are more likely to ride a bike from the residence hall down to a math building rather than riding back up to the residence hall. So we kind of brought up some solutions that they thought of, some incentives, either through a point system or maybe free rides for them. They were receptive to this, and this is also a tactic that other stations bike shares such as Sony use to use the incentives to get people to do the redistribution for them instead of paying. So looking at our user policy that Luke briefly mentioned, this is a strictly on-campus system at the moment. So this means that only on-campus bike share or bike racks are allowed to be used by the bikes. This allows us, the red bar administrators, to know where all the bikes are in the system, and it also allows all the users to be able to access them. Another, however, we also look at the user accountability. So the last user is the one that is accountable for blocking the bike. If bike is stolen or anything happens to the bike after the user's finished, we do have their information. We can go back and see if the bike was locked properly. If it was not, then that user would be held accountable. The last we talked about was the return policy. So instead of the whole objective of the bike share is so the bike share can run the degree. And if a student could run a bike for 8 hours, also those that need it in an emergency situation. We also will target the semester and year populations, those are the rest of the students. The amount of each subscription can kind of be up to the university that's administering the system. Our rough estimate was going to be that the semester rate would be $25 to $50. So how do we decide how many bikes we need on the parallel campus? So what we did is we looked at two types of bike shares, those in metropolitan areas and those in current universities. What we found is that for the bike density of 10,000 people, it's much higher at universities. This makes sense because the majority of people on university will be more likely than the majority of people in a metropolitan area. So what we wanted to focus on was achieving a 20 bike per 10,000 people density, which would be approximately 80 bikes on UMD's campus. So looking at how much does Red Bar cost, the bike with all the locking and tech on it would be approximately $1,000 per unit. 60% of this is devoted just to the lock manufacturing. And when you manufacture locks and more and more mass produce them, that figure would go down. The coverage region, all the 56 nodes that we've talked about, would only be approximately $3,500. So when we extrapolate that out to our 80 bike system that we would propose, the total amount of the system, just for startup, would be $85,000. This falls in that range of one capital lecture system that Tom mentioned earlier. And as it turns out, actually next month, Maryland's actually bringing a bike share to campus that's going to be a station-based one. 7 stations around campus, 120 bikes. We figured, let's see how much our system would cost for 120 bikes. We found that it would be approximately $125,000, which is one third of the price of the grant that UMD received to start their bike share. So you're already seeing the cost savings there. So in conclusion, future directions, we need to figure out a better power solution rather than operating the locks and batteries, which is the current state. Either exploring solar panels and dynamo energy to make the locks and bikes themselves more sustainable. We also learned to look at the reinforced snow lock material so that the lock is as secure as possible as it can be. Finally, we want to get a pilot program on campus. That way we can kind of understand the nuances and kind of peculiarities of running such a system. We'd like to send our special thanks to our mentor faculty, our two librarians, Mr. Serval and Ms. Dassel. Dr. Bonner, for allowing us to use their lab space, the UMD Sustainability Fund for their grant, and all the Johnson staff for all the support they've given us over the past 4 years. Before we get to questions, we're going to start a video, just an ad for our bike share.
Hello, my name is Tim Bonner. I'm the co-founder of Red Bar, college bike share system. With Red Bar, any registered student can use our app on their smartphone to locate an available bike on campus. Once located, the user can unlock the bike by using their designated NFC-enabled ID card that they receive upon registration. The student is then free to ride anywhere on campus. When finished riding, the student can return the bike and lock it properly at any ride on campus. Once secured, the ride is over and the bike is available for the next user. Students can also locate and reserve bikes through a website. Network is designed by college students for college students. The fact that bikes can be returned any bike ride on campus offers students freedom, flexibility, and not found in their bike shares. For more information on our system, such as the lock, RFID technology, and mesh communication technology, please visit our website, redbarbikes.com.
Right, it's not as much, it's kind of a
things and about things that happen to us, but things you do along with your confidence systems you can do that.
As part of converting the bikes into our bike share bikes, we will be going and buying on-market products. So they have locking skewers that make it much more difficult for anyone on the street to remove bikes. They have the same for the seat posts. As far as getting stuck in a river, that is part of the agreement that we are able to track who the last user was. So if we determine that one ended up in a lake right off campus, then we'd be able to find out who the last person was and find out if they had locked them correctly. And if they hadn't, that they would be the ones most.
So we do think about the cloning of the NFC tags. So I actually have like so some it'll look like this, but it's very easy to clone it. One thing is that these cards have innate security in it as well. So each card would have a unique identification. That is set by the manufacturer and must be ordered from the manufacturer. It's very highly secure. You have to go through the manufacturer in order to get the unique identification, and then you will match that identification to the user. These cards also come with standard American encryption standard of 128 bits. If you want, you can go up to 256 bits. Let's say, for example, someone really, really wanted to copy one, then technically, yes, they could. There's no way we can make it completely foolproof, but they would have to come within a distance of at least 30 centimeters to the user with the tag. And it's going by our assumption that, you know, if someone comes up to you and tries to like get really close to you with like a big machine trying to beat it, it might be a little bit suspicious. So we try to foolproof it as much as we can. We can't foolproof it 100%. We think it's the best we can do.
Did you guys look into how difficult it is to duplicate an iPhone number, like your telephone number? It's pretty difficult. So why wouldn't you just use iPhone number, your cell phone, and the computer would detect who you are, and you saw one body number 32, and computer for the list a lot.
I can take this one. So we did consider using the phones as the access point, but part of the drawbacks there is that we, one, limit the users to people just with the smartphones that we make the system for, and then two, is we only have the ability to talk to the device. when someone approaches it with a smartphone with our device. So instead of doing that, we want the ability to talk to and from the bike whenever we wanted to. So with our system, we can actually ping the bike without any of our users being here.
But if you use the bike, you can tell where the cell phones are. How many of you don't have a smartphone? So you have existing technology that's very cheap. You're investing $4,000 to protect the $50 bike.
Well, one of the drawbacks of that cell phone, the existing technology, is we also lose capabilities. So like if we wanted to talk to the bike because we needed to push like an update to it, or if we just wanted to check to make sure it was available, if we're relying on the user's smartphone, we're relying on the user being near the bike. So we can't talk to the bike when the user's not near the bike. We want the smartphone to have it.
There is also the issue of tracking individual users though. And there would be many users that would be less excited about having our system track their phones.
What if we want to track?
But not by a college lecture.
Sign up, sign the waiver. You'd be saying if anything.
while riding this bike. It's my own fault, kind of putting my eye on another user. Those are those fine prints that really no one ever reads. People assign, so we're hoping that people won't catch them.
Buying our own patent and attending our own class. We haven't finalized it.